Red Mania is in full effect.
Follow me, I'm show you how I do this right here.
My man 50 Cent.
Hot. Wangsta. Hot.
They say you a wangsta, but you never stop, right?
In the club. Hot.
It's your birthday. He a bad boy, you know what I'm saying? He a bad boy.
50 Cent Mania is to rap what Beatlemania was to rock music back in the day, man. You feel a lot of pressure?
The G-Unit General has the number one album in the country with the bullet.
50 Cent has hit music.
I told you I was getting hot.
Reborn after getting shot, re-signed to Shady Records, remixed by M and Dre.
I wish my first album was this hot.
In the next half hour, we go behind the hype and into the head of 50 to find out about his loss.
You were 8 years old when your mother was murdered? What did they say?
They told me your mother is not coming home.
His love.
Eminem and Dre is basically getting you women.
Absolutely.
And his legacy.
People compare you to Tupac Shakur.
That's a scary comparison.
You know it. He knows it. All eyes are on 50 Cent.
Yes, it's all eyes on me now, right?
Go, go. Go, go. Go, go. Go, shawty. It's your birthday. We gon' party like it's your birthday.
Miami, a full force promo tour in support of the debut album from 50 Cent, has every club from San Fran to South Beach mobbed with fans. And we're riding there in style. 50's level 4 bulletproof, bomb-proof SUV.
That's my truck right there, you see what I'm saying?
I can't help but think 50 could have used this protection 3 years ago, when 50 Cent Mania nearly didn't happen. When he was just an unknown rapper struggling to get out of the hood, and almost never did.
Were you scared for your life?
What I was scared the whole time.
Okay.
Ain't nobody gonna tell you they ain't scared. It's a hit, man. You're supposed to die.
Can you recall what it felt like? Like when the bullets entered your flesh.
I mean, it burns.
Yeah?
Burns, burns, burns. Sometimes it happens so fast, you know, you can't move. Mm-hmm. You know, time to think.
Yeah, they all
time to do nothing. It's just, the first reaction is to move, and then the shots is going off.
You had to rehabilitate, right?
Yeah.
How long did it take you to get where
about
you were?
5 months. 4 or 5 months.
Wow, that's a long process, and people don't think about, you think you get shot and jump back up and go play hoop in the hood.
You know what happened is I was walking, but on one of those things like this, but I couldn't put much pressure on that neither because my thumb, it came from my thumb and then came out my pinky.
Now, let me see your the bullet wound in your mouth. Oh, wow. It took the whole.
You're lying with the gums.
And then where did that exit?
It didn't.
It's still in there?
Nah, it came out.
And that affects how you rap your at all?
Slightly. Uh-huh. My voice changed a little bit because of the air.
So in a matter of basically 3 years, you've gone from literally fighting for your life on the gurney in the hospital with full of bullet holes to being the hottest rapper in the business right now.
I'm almost the hottest rapper. I signed a deal with the hottest
rapper. You signed a deal with the hottest rapper.
Hey, Em, you know you're my favorite white boy, right? Y'all know what time it is. Soon as 50 signs on his dot.
I had actually been in a slump, like, where is hip-hop gonna go? And then when I heard 50 stuff, it was like, when I heard his new shit, it was like, oh, okay.
M is the rapper's rapper. He listens to everything. Every word, every slang, if you change something, he's gonna hear it all. And M likes to build records around me.
You should throw stones if you live in a glass house. And if you got a glass jaw, you should watch your mouth.
As an artist, M uses so much of his life. It's visible. Like, you know who Kim is, you know who Haley is, you know how his relationship with his mother is, because he uses his life. And my music is similar to that on that note. Like, I use my life, but it's more a description of my neighborhood, my hood, you know, and that's what I wrote about. And he was able to see those qualities in me early. You know, that's what drew him to me.
What about Dre?
Dre, like, he'll play, he'll have beats, and then it's like, he got these beats, then you might charge you half of your budget for, and then you have these beats over here, you know. But the automatic, these are the hits, 50, so pick one of these and make a couple of singles or something.
Do I think Eminem and Dr. Dre is responsible for a lot of my success? I'ma say, hell yeah.
top.
And what does Dre tell you? Can you share that with us?
Well, he, you know, tried to tell me to stay focused. You know, because I told him in the beginning what I wanted, like my intentions weren't to just be trouble. Nobody wants to buy a problem. You know, and then with my background, there's a possibility that they could be purchasing the biggest problem that they found.
The advance you got from Shady Aftermath, it was reported that it was $1 million deal.
I ended up with $1 million.
Now, before Drain Him, you were signed with Columbia Records, but you departed and went your separate ways.
When I signed my deal with Columbia, it wasn't a great deal. I was left with $5,000.
What'd you do with it?
I bought crack with it. I sold crack during that whole time period.
Would you?
I had no option. How else would I provide for myself financially? Mm-hmm. And I just had my son. That was the reason why I started attempting to do music. I'm not trying to impress anybody with any of that. This is the situations that have just happened. These are the cards I've been dealt. You feel me? I actually wouldn't glorify you being gangster. That's nothing you're supposed to glorify. That's something that happens to you. You don't say, I want to sell drugs. I would never sell drugs if I didn't feel like that was absolutely the only way for me to progress at that point. I had stopped selling drugs in order to rap.
I've been patiently waiting to blow, ladies and gentlemen.
You got a record on your album. Is it Back Down?
Back Down.
Back Down. That's pretty much an ode to Ja Rule.
Yeah.
So break down your beef with Ja Rule.
It's obvious when you name your company Murder Inc., you would like to portray a certain image. His music does not coincide with the image that he would like to portray.
I'm back in the game, shawty, the ruling conquer. Sing for the sound like the cookie monster.
He'd like to be like 50 Cent. He like to speak about things that happen in the neighborhood that they won't accept from him. Cause he hasn't lived anything like that. His life is nothing like that.
I'm New York City's own bad guy.
What are the possibilities of this ever just being squashed and maybe you guys doing a record for charity? Is that possible?
Impossible. What's possible is that he can progress on his own mm-hmm. while I progress doing what I do. This is impossible for us to ever be friends.
You date?
Nah, I'm not dating. I'm focused.
You know, you don't go out occasionally.
Yeah.
Turn on your TV. We are
here with the man 50 Cent.
Go to the club.
We in the club doing the same old two-step.
Hang out on any corner.
That's your day.
And 50 Cent has got the phrase that pays.
Said you a gangster,
but you never stop, right?
Hey, don't think that 50's explosion onto the pop scene affects his street credibility. He was born gangster.
Go against me for show, you're a goner.
And while 50 claims there's no glory in being gangster, his thug lyrics are a big reason he's on top of the game.
Even though it's your truth, mm-hmm. a lot of the music you make and the things you rap about has a lot to do with violence mm-hmm. and murder.
Yeah.
Do you believe that by putting that energy out, that it might come back?
To me?
Yeah.
I don't think so. It's what was my reality to this point. I think being creative, writing music, that those the things I'm writing to you are about my experiences. Mm-hmm. You know, it's entertainment, but it's definitely my reality from the hood.
You were 8 years old when your mother was murdered?
Yeah.
How did you find out? I mean, where were you?
My grandmother and them told me.
Yeah. What did they say?
They told me your mother is not coming home. That she's not gonna come back to pick you up. She's gonna stay with us now. She was like into the streets too, so she hustled. Mm-hmm. And like,
so what, she sold drugs?
Yeah, sold drugs. Okay. She used to be on 150th Street. That's what made it easier for me to get involved with selling drugs.
Mm-hmm.
Because I had all of the people that I had met young, they'd be like, oh, that's a Brennan's little boy.
Mm-hmm.
Were all people who sold drugs. Mm-hmm. So it was like, you know, when I ended up, like, I was, like, 12. I was having a hard time in school.
In high school?
Yeah.
You can make it.
What high school did you go to?
I went to Andrew Jackson. I got kicked out of Andrew Jackson High School.
Well, what you do, look under the girl's skirt?
Nah, I got arrested in Jackson High School. Like, at that point, I was hustling, so I was hiding my pieces, my drawers from my grandmother, and I had it in a pair of gym shoes, and I picked up the wrong gym shoe. At our high school, we had metal detectors. So when we went through the metal detection at the high school, they found the pieces, and they locked me up. I went through a whole few weeks out of school because they thought that I was selling drugs in the school.
Were you?
Nah.
Who did you hang out with in high school? Who was the homies?
Everybody was older than me. Like, I never really hung around people my age. They all, like, that's why I don't have a serious peer group now, because everybody that's my age, I was running with the older crew, so they all locked up or, you know, dead.
I've been patiently waiting for a track that's rolled on me.
Now, when did you decide to become a rapper, though?
I decided that when I had the opportunity. Being honest, like, I always played with rapping. I played around, you know, my man had turntables, we'd be in his basement, the instrumentals on the records, and we just all just rap to him. But I didn't seriously consider being a rapper until I was in a conversation with Jam Master J.
This the new era right here, check my man out, 56.
Really, what year was that?
That was in, I think, 97.
That was only like 5-6 years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah? What did he teach you how to rap, or you just...
Now, I knew how to rap, but I never had recorded a song. I didn't know song format, 16 bars. I didn't know how to count bars. Now, you know, chorus space, 4 bars, 8-bar hooks, or however you're going to do it. I learned all of that from Jay, working with Jay. But he said that I had the right lyrics.
To make it up, I do whatever it take. I love you like a fat kid love cake.
But I know you got a song called 21 Questions.
Yeah.
And then you also got a song called Pimp.
Yeah, I'm going to be right
here. Yeah, on the album. And it seemed like those are directed towards, you know, women. Are you single right now?
Yeah.
You single? You date?
Nah, I'm not dating. I'm focused.
You focused?
Yeah.
Bro, you're not going out, you know, you don't go out occasionally, you know.
I don't really
Are you celibate?
I don't go out. Nah, I ain't celibate.
Can I be your Valentine?
You can be my Valentine.
So if a woman came up to you right now and was like, man, I'm interested in you. I really want to, you know, you know, maybe move forward on something.
That happens a lot now, though.
Yeah?
It happens so often now, it makes you feel awkward.
So what kind of...
I feel like I got a facelift.
You feel like you got a facelift?
Yeah. Because you treat me so much better now.
You think it's
the world? Oh, he's the kind of dude with Eminem.
So Eminem and Dre is basically getting you women.
Absolutely.
What would you do on a date, man? What would 50 Cent take a girl
out of? It'd be hard. Now I need to just... Let me come watch your TV. Let me watch your TV.
Okay.
Like, I don't necessarily like to go out too much.
So you keep it indoors?
Yeah, I'm my own body.
Okay. You're single, so you and your son's mother are obviously not together, do you?
Yeah, but we cool, though. We down for life.
Yeah.
So, you know, anybody who I would kick it with, I have to accept that.
They gotta accept the baby mama and the baby.
Yeah.
Okay, and there's no baby mama drama.
No.
None of that.
No.
Okay.
My baby mother, she's special.
You don't have a song really where you kind of dedicated to your son on your album. Is there a reason why?
I don't think people are interested in hearing that from me at this point. I think it's been, I'm more popular for Trouble. And it is. I don't think they want to hear my personal business right now.
What made you decide to put him in the video, though, the Wangsta video?
I want to show him different things. Like, right now, he thinks he's Romeo. Oh, Bow Wow, one of them.
Oh, yeah. He thinks he's Romeo,
yeah,
or Bow Wow?
Yeah, he thinks he's a star.
So he's rapping and
he said, yo, my video is coming off.
Does he ask you, Daddy, why did you get shot?
I mean, nah, he never asks questions.
Like, he never asks you that?
You know, I think he understands it, but he just... I mean, that's not a regular experience for kids.
Yeah, that's not a regular experience.
You know, you know what I mean? Like, yeah. So he's gonna
for
be,
anybody, yeah.
It's gonna be affected by the way my life is anyway.
Is there anything that you fear?
If you haven't figured it out yet,
50 Cent Mania is real. The man behind it is real.
Yo, 50 is strictly for the streets. If you ain't gangster enough, then you can't understand the movement.
Bah, what up, homie?
But what's his real motivation in life? 50 Cent is a man driven by many things. From God.
Gotta be something, gotta believe in a higher power.
To money.
Difference bling, bling, must bling, laugh.
To fear.
Ain't nobody gonna tell you that he's good.
In this motivated approach to the game, there's only one reason why 50 Cent is already being compared to a rap legend.
You know, because of a lot of the things you've gone through in your life, in terms of, you know, let's be frank, this kind of a dysfunctional family situation, being shot, you know, now having the heart of the street on your side, you know, and then you're always in media now. People compare you to Tupac Shakur.
That's a scary comparison. Cuz Tupac is a legend. I'm just a new boy. I'm a new kid.
It's a lot of similarities in the way he lived and the way you live now. You have a song called Many Men. You know, what you
That's
say.
That's my favorite record.
You allude to the fact that Pac got shot in the fest, never figured out who it was. You say things like, I don't cry no more, I don't look to the sky no more. You know, that. Do you feel that way sometimes, that, you know, your life might come to a sudden halt, or somebody might try to kill you?
Well, I know that, you know, death is promised. When you get in life-threatening situations, I think that might have been why Tupac started writing like that so much. After he'd been shot up. You know, you find yourself in life-threatening situations, you kind of got to deal with that mentally. That, you know, if you're not in control of it, and death is promise. He who fears death is in denial.
You got a song called If I Could Make It to Heaven?
Yeah.
You know.
Gotta make it to heaven for going through hell.
So you believe in the heaven and in the hell?
Yeah.
You always wearing crosses. So are you a religious dude?
Yeah, like, I believe in God.
Which religion do you follow?
I don't go to church. My mother raised us Baptist.
Raised you Baptist. I can see you going to church every Sunday, man.
Nah, I don't do that.
Mama said everything happened to us was part of God's plan. So at night when I talked to him, I got my gun in my hand.
But is there any moral conflict? You know, like if you
Absolutely.
Worship the cross, it is, but you live by the gun.
You don't have an option. My lifestyle hasn't coincided with what I was raised to believe all my life.
You know, I've been to the pearly gates that sent me back.
Just before you fall asleep and you think about how much transition your life has taken, what do you think?
I'm excited. Mm-hmm. I feel blessed. I feel like I'm here for a reason. You know, I think it's to do something positive, you know, but I think anything that changes too fast is no good. So you shouldn't expect me to come in next week or walk around with a Bible.
The title of the album is Get Rich or Die Trying. A lot of people read that title and think, oh, man, there he goes again, man, talking about death and money. Can you explain that?
It may feel like a negative statement coming from me, get rich or die trying. But if your average working class person said that they're gonna get rich or die trying, it means that they're focused.
Focus, man. My money on my mind. Got a meal out the deal and I'm still in the grind.
You have a very, very colorful life. Past and present. And you pretty much have a, it seemed like a positive take on all of it. But you're still a man, you know. When you're still mortal, is there anything that you fear?
I fear. I fear not fitting in with Eminem and Dr. Dre. That's my pressure. Nothing else counts to me right now.
One of his first songs was Hi, My Name Is, and then look at the sales, so don't put that kind of pressure on me, you know what I mean?
It's no pressure.
Nobody likes me.
With all the bulletproof vests and the guns and the cop chase, you know, coming down on you, the only thing you fear right now is Eminem and Dr. Dre.
Absolutely.
Okay.
That's what counts to me. That other stuff has already been a part of my life.
Okay.
None of that is new.
All right. And at this moment in your life, are you happy?
Absolutely.
100%.
Yeah, man, I show you my teeth so much you get tired. You be like, man, is everything they said about him true? Because he out there showing his teeth like he's happy.
Sold worldwide. 50 Cent.
Well, I sell one record under what I sold on my first album in my head. That's a failure.
He set his sights on number one.
You've had this success. You don't need Eminem and Dre to sell records anymore.
And now he stands alone.
Is it lonely at the top?
When hip-hop is an empire, being the boss means defending your turf.
I still heard what you said. You should have kept that in your house.
And any artist gunning for his spot will have to face the massacre.
They'll see more damage done than they've ever seen before.
From behind closed doors, in a place where the powerful rise and fall.
That's for you doing that, and you're gonna accept that.
The new boss would like to see you.
Once again, all eyes on me.
On 50 Cent, the sequel. New York City. All eyes are on 50 Cent. Again. In just 2 years, the young soldier has elevated to boss status in the world of hip-hop. It was appropriate then that we convene at a place the legendary bosses would approve of. Sparks Steakhouse in New York City, site of the infamous hit on Gambino crime boss Paul Castellano. Big Pauly often held court in the private Rose Room at Sparks. And even today, you can feel the ghosts watching over. This is the only place to discuss the massacre.
All right, 50, here we go again. All right, now throughout the years, the big bosses in New York City, yeah, they've all come here to conduct business and wine and dine. So since you graduated, we thought it'd be fitting that we have you sit at this table while you and I get down to business. All right? Let's start with the title of your album, The Massacre. Why did you call it The Massacre?
I think it's aggressive enough. I think that it's going to be hard for my fellow artists to survive.
Well, you predicting that once this album drops, you're going to knock all your competitors off the charts, out of the game.
They'll see more damage done than they've ever seen before. You know what I'm saying? On the scale of success that I've had with Get Rich or Die Trying, I understand exactly why I get the envy and the jealousy that I have going on with me in New York City, particularly in New York City. And my last LP sold more than everyone who's released the album. And would you consider New York City hip-hop?
Absolutely.
Every single one of them. Add them all up. And it ain't 11 million records.
Any of these guys take shots at you. If anybody want to challenge you in your career, your profession, your safety.
It's cool. I'm from an environment where the price of life is cheap. This is what I'm used to. It's actually a comfort zone for me to have issues.
The Massacre finds 50 feeling real comfortable, and his swagger's definitely evident as he verbally attacks foes, old and new.
You got a record called Piggy Bank.
Yeah.
And in this record, you diss Fat Joe, you diss Jadakiss, and you diss Nas.
You know, I didn't diss anybody. I made factual statements about them. I'm responding to the things that they're doing. I hear everything, every little thing, things that they would probably think didn't count because it didn't do anything for their career.
Mm-hmm.
I still heard what you said.
So what is it that you confronted on this record, Piggy Bank, concerning Jada, Fat Joe, in general?
I'm responding to the things that they're doing. I mean, it's been visible.
I'm from New York, and this is how we do.
That song, New York, features Jadakiss and Fat Joe rapping alongside Ja Rule, whose own beef with 50 stems from an old street rivalry in Queens. In 50's eyes, that means they've chosen size.
They come from environments where they know. Mm-hmm. And they ain't in the dark. They know what it is. Mm-hmm. This is not music beef. Uh-huh. Now, it doesn't stem from music. It comes from actual street. Now, that don't die. So it's like, you don't stand so close to that person mm-hmm. that you're viewed as an ally to him. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm going to sit back so you can try and help him. Mm-hmm. That's exactly what they did with I'm From New York.
Now, on The Massacre, 50's upping the lyrical ante.
That fat thought lean back was in the club. My sold 11 mil. This was a dud.
That's me saying, you know what? That's for you doing that, and you're going to accept that. Mm-hmm. If you keep responding, I'll keep going until you don't exist anymore.
So you're not fearful of the backlash that could come from
backlash of what? See, you know what? You got to have a legitimate opponent to respect them. Mm-hmm. Fat Joe and Jadakiss, come on, baby. This don't even count, baby.
I mean, you know combined, I mean? I mean, they sell records. They got credibility.
They sell a million. They probably sell 1.5 together. Their last two releases add up to 1,500,000 copies, both of them together.
Jadakiss is a well-liked guy. There's not many people in too many places who doesn't like
him. If you want to be technical, there's a lot of people, a lot of places that don't even know who Jadakiss is. I've been in markets that have no idea who Jadakiss is.
Who's your favorite music?
50 Cent
gets everywhere.
You know, I performed in Nigeria in front of 100,000 people by myself. Go to Nigeria and ask them about Fat Joe and Jadakiss. Mm-hmm. And I didn't know who you're talking about. Mm-hmm. Dubai, go there, go to all these different places. They don't know these people.
What happened with R. Kelly in the summer when you went on stage and verbally attacked R. Kelly?
He had made the song that he has out with Ja Rule and Ashanti.
Just like Fat Joe and Jadakiss, R. Kelly's appearance with Ja on the track Wonderful made him guilty by collaboration. And that drew 50's wrath before Kelly took the stage at a New York radio concert last summer.
It was a possibility we'd be bringing him out. So I damaged the situation before he had the opportunity. I went on before him, I said what I said, and as I left, 60% of the building left with us. Mm-hmm. And I mean, he came out about 45 minutes later and did his set. He didn't bring Ja with him, but he could've. So I had to do it to him, because he could've. I don't actually have issues with R. Kelly.
You don't have an issue with him, but he probably has an issue with you.
I don't give a f*** about an issue. R. Kelly, they f*** that.
So that was like a preempted strike?
Yeah.
All right.
At this particular point, if I let up off a Murdine, right? They linger for a little bit. People start to feel like it's okay to like them. Mm-hmm. They get back in position, then guess what? They want to fight again. You know, now they want to, ooh, peace treaty, white flag, everybody, ooh, please get up off us. This kid is killing us. But when you let them get back up on their feet, they want to fight again. That's why I said, for me, when you begin to destroy, you should destroy completely.
When do you get to the point, though, that you ignore those things and it's beyond you, or it's beneath you, so to speak, and it's like, oh, come on, man, that's a fly hitting a brick wall? Or do you ever get to that point?
You know what I think? I think the actions come from the interactions with the guy in the spot before me. Mm-hmm. That's Jay-Z. And I think Jay-Z, he doesn't mind them saying things and doing what they're doing, because he's looking at him like, yeah, bum ass. Mm-hmm. You know, so he ain't saying nothing to them because he feel like they're beneath him. You know, but I got the time and energy to ruin what is left of their careers if they want to do that.
Is that a true lyric that you had sex with a lot of Hollywood actresses? You don't necessarily need Eminem and Dre to sell records anymore.
All eyes on 50 Cent, the sequel.
Make no mistake, 50 Cent is still on top of his game. And he's back with a new album aimed at anyone gunning for his spot, The Massacre.
Other artists, they would rather see me do bad. You know, so it kind of fuels me, though. It gives me the energy to keep working.
If your records aren't surrounded by drama or beef, do you still think you have the same appeal to the consumer on the street?
Absolutely. None of those issues or things that you're saying sell records. That may create gossip. It may create talk in the neighborhood. Mm-hmm. You know, if there's a possibility it could really get bad. Mm-hmm. just because people love trouble. You know, they want to watch, they want to see it up close. It's the reason why I pick up the newspaper every day. Ain't nothing good in it. But none of my singles commercially have been those records.
Okay.
You know, in the club, you think that wouldn't have sold a record without anything else being on it?
What's the story behind In the Club? It almost wasn't yours, right?
Yeah, it actually was given to D12 first. And then I guess they just didn't hear themselves over the record, you know, but when I heard it, I was like, shit, let me get that.
Yeah.
You know, but In the Club, P.I.M.P., 21 Questions, these records are not records addressing anybody.
You know, all eyes are on 50 Cent again, so to speak, but in a sense, they never left because unlike your mentor, Dr. Dre, who might drop an album every 7 years, you never left.
Well, I'm making up almost 70% of the black music at Interscope Records.
Mm-hmm.
So it'd be a long time for you to see me just disappear because I took my energy and I've utilized it in the right ways to create new artists, new avenues.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say 50 Cent record doesn't meet standards.
Mm-hmm.
People decide they don't want to buy it. That doesn't damage Lloyd Banks, who's going to continue to sell records. Doesn't damage Youngboy, who's going to continue to sell records. All game.
But are you fearful of becoming oversaturated where people have heard you so much that it's like, oh man, another 50 Cent record?
I don't believe in oversaturation. Okay. I think that counts to artists that can't continue to recreate themselves.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't feel like I'm oversaturated because I gave them different records.
Mm-hmm.
You could have got P.I.M.P., you could have got that from Snoop, you could have got that from Nelly. You could have got that from Too Short, I'm High All the Time. You could have got that from Snoop. You could have got that from Method Man. These are people who consistently sell 500,000 records basing their entire album on that particular thing. I Take My Shirt Off. You can get that from LL. You can get that from DMX. These things have been seen before. It's been done. It's just you haven't had one person be able to execute all of it. That's the difference.
Let me ask you this question. When you first came in the game, one of the points that you made about Ja Rule as an artist is the fact that he sings in his choruses. He got a bunch of love songs for girls.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you sing in your choruses. Mm-hmm. You make love songs for girls on the radio.
I've made one record.
Okay.
And I didn't actually sing on the chorus. Smile. I
want
to be a reason to smile.
Yeah. But what would be the difference between Ja Rule then and 50 Cent now?
The lyrical content.
Mm-hmm.
The content is still so much stronger than what they've done.
So you would argue the fact that even though you guys do similar tactics and records, you and Ja Rule, that it's a total difference.
I made a record like that.
Okay.
And that's me diversifying what they've seen from me, not being the norm.
When it comes to making hits, 50 claims he's a true P.I.M.P. And that would appear to carry benefits beyond the charts.
He wrote a song, it's called Writer Music, something to the effect that I've had sex, but half of Hollywood are probably your favorite actress. Is that a true lyric that you've had sex with a lot of Hollywood actresses?
Let me ask you something, right?
Okay.
I want to ask you a question. You've asked me a lot of questions. You think that's possible?
Do I think it's possible that you've had sex with? Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Then that's good enough right there. As long as they think it's possible, that's good, you know?
From Hollywood to Hollis, 50's had them in a frenzy. But true bosses parlay, and 50's parlay 50 Mania into 50 Inc.
Since we talked last, not only have you sold over 10 million records, not to mention the records you sold under the radar, the mixtape records,
and
the little side deals you might have caught, you know, and then you got G-Unit clothing, sneakers, you got the G-Unit watch, 50 vitamin water.
It was always a plan for that. Like, when I started my record, Give It to Die Trying, the first statement I made is G-Unit. Bo, we in here.
Mm-hmm.
I apply the same ethics that I learned from the block to this business. I keep working out nonstop.
But then you get into this business so you could leave that whole block mentality. You want
to
leave?
No, not the mentality. Leave the block.
Okay.
Is what I was trying to do. Get away from it. That mentality is what I've known to just stay on the corner. I stay on the corner as long as there's money coming. And that's what I'm going to do. In the entertainment business, I'm going to be on the TV as long as they're paying me. That's it. It's the same thing. And I feel like consistency is the key to all success, and as long as you can consistently keep good product, they're going to come buy it.
The New York Times reported that in 2004, 50 Cent made $50 million, and that's a piggy bank that's got him standing toe-to-toe with mentors Eminem and Dr. Dre.
Him and Dre both for Boston.
Mm-hmm.
So now I fit in, and I fit as a third party, and I'm working my way to being respected as if I'm equivalent.
So how does that work now? You've had this success, and the dynamic of the hierarchy starts to change because you don't necessarily need Eminem and Dre to sell records anymore.
Ultimately, Dre holds the most weight.
Okay.
But I'm straight. I don't need for it to be made by a specific producer.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of times, it'd be new producers. This guy made his beat in the basement.